Good evening. Welcome to our third installment of Discursives, a lecture series that invites poets to experiment with the boundaries of the lecture format and test its implicit and explicit structures and assumptions. We usually host these events in the same chapel where Emerson first delivered his controversial Divinity School address, but given the AV needs that even Emerson's infamous eyeball could not have foreseen, we moved it here to the building that houses the English department. And in some ways, this new location is wonderfully pertinent to our guest's presentation tonight. The very difficulty I, English major, had in trying to interpret Tan Lin's event description, which I woefully mangled in our publicity by subtitling a PowerPoint event and, alternatively, an experimental poetry lecture, is part of the genius of Tan Lin's unsettling and subversive work. And his presentation tonight in the very building in which PowerPoint has been used and abused as a passive sidekick to countless professional academic lectures, no offense intended to some, otherwise known as death by PowerPoint, will no doubt challenge the various zone-out modes we enter when such technologies are deployed and activate the site of intersection between reading and seeing. In Tan Lin's work, we experience images that can be read and languages that can be viewed. Tan Lin's mode of literature constantly forces us to recognize how we read and are always reading our texts and environments according to methods and guidelines we are not entirely conscious of, what he has called, quote, the commodification of attention. Here to decommodify our attention this evening is Tan Lin. Please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you very much, everyone, for coming on such a cold night. Tonight I'm gonna be delivering two lectures, I guess. They're PowerPoint lectures. One is called Bibliographic Soundtrack, and it runs 45 minutes. And the second one is called the Ph.D. Sound. I know there are lots of academics in the room, so. But I always say I was at Columbia and it took me 15 years to get a PhD, so it was an extremely protracted experience. But I found that after 7 or 8 years, bibliography started to look kind of sexy. So I'm going to show, as I said, two videos. I was interested in PowerPoint as a medium because it has sort of an interesting history. It comes out in sort of 88. And it's a device, it's really a tool, it's not really sort of envisioned even as software. It's a tool for making overhead transparencies, and it's a kind of lights are on in the room kind of experience in 88. In 90, PowerPoint introduces a series of sort of photographic slide motifs, and it becomes a darkroom experience. And by 96 or 98, at the third iteration of PowerPoint, you get the addition of sort of screen titles, fading things, dissolves, so it becomes a much more filmic platform. And I was told that in 2011 they switched the formats to 16:9 from 4:3. I'm not sure if this is true or not, but it's interesting in that PowerPoint is sort of adapting to what I would call a multimedia reading environment. So when I did these pieces in PowerPoint, I was interested in seeing, well, what would a work of literature or a poem look like in PowerPoint, and how have reading practices changed? As Christina has pointed out, you know, there's this thing known as PowerPoint hell. And I did want to milk those possibilities for this piece. So I wanted a work that would be extremely long, durational, boring, and you know, it would incite a certain amount of distraction. So we'd like you to keep your phones on for this. And as I said, it runs about 45 minutes. We're gonna show it for 25, and then I'm gonna screen another short video that has a musical soundtrack. Okay, so, oh, and you know what, I'll take Q&A after this screening. I thought it'd be more interactive, and then I'll introduce the PhD sounds, okay? this goes on for a long time. I mean, I wanted to do something that would go on for like 24 hours, be really slow, extremely boring. I don't know if it, but and I'd been, you know, I'd been reading, there are two videos that you'll see, two lectures that you'll see today. This is the first one. And I'd been reading Ian Bogost's book. He wrote an interesting book called Unit Operations. And in some sense, each of these panes or slides, I mean, it's interesting. PowerPoint sort of references, as I said, you have the overhead, you have the overhead transparency, you have a photo or a slide, and you have sort of filmic, filmic references, but you also have a number of residual formats, including the lecture and the book. So these are all integrated in this sort of multimedia reading platform. And I think reading practices are sort of extremely varied. And this was an attempt to sort of test extremely slow, distracted reading practices in a sort of confined space. In this case, a sort of malign genre of office productivity software, and what would literature actually look like as it transpired in that medium. So Bogost divides video games into sort of two broad categories. One is a sort of lean back game, which induces meditation and drift. So I would say this is kind of meditative, drift-like, distracted reading. And the video that I'll screen next induces anxiety and twitchiness. And it's a lean forward kind of reading experience. So most of this stuff was not written by me. It's mostly appropriated text. And I was interested in specifically the intersection between, I would say, I would call them communications mediums. So there's a lot of SMS here. There's a fair amount of IM. A lot of this stuff is from video game walkthroughs, which are also, I think, time sensitive. And literature typically represses both its medial platform. I mean, one tends to forget that one's reading a book when one's reading a book. But this is not really true with PowerPoint. One is aware that one is being tortured by PowerPoint, or that one is confined by PowerPoint in a chair. So this is one of the reasons why you're all sitting down and we turned out the lights, because you just, I mean, people don't expect to see a movie or to read a novel when they go to the movie theater, one word at a time. So that's one of the things we were after here. The other thing I suppose is, well, PowerPoint, as a medium, is, as I said, extremely rich in terms of the various platforms it references. And it's extremely spatial, too. So a lot of the text was being presented here. I mean, when you think of a novel, you think of, oh, I'm going to read in a sort of solitary way, and I'm going to read in a sort of teleologically directed linear kind of way. But here, you get all sorts of different spatializations of text. So you'll get things mounted from the bottom. You get things coming down from the top. You'll get left to right and right to left scrolling. You'll get erasure letter by letter or word by word. And these are all different ways of sort of text parsing. So in one sense, what the sort of piece is about is, I suppose, rethinking reading practices in terms of what I would call information management, maybe, or content aggregation, and that these might serve as models. And I think maybe what's taking place is maybe a different idea of what the human body is as it relates to textual processing or even retinal processing. And so maybe in the 19th century we thought of the human body as a thermodynamic engine that burns glucose and fat and protein. But now we think of the human body as an information gate that processes information. So this is really reading, I think, as information management or processing at some level. And it's very slow, or most of it's very slow. So there's a lot of Twitter in here. There's a lot of stuff from microblogging platforms like Tumblr in here. I wrote some poems in Twitter, so these are incorporated. They were tweeted by somebody else. There's a lot of sort of joint authorship and communal reading. I think the other interesting thing about sort of turning off the lights and doing reading in a cinematic setting is, well, you're looking up, first of all, and the text is moving, unlike in a codex. So these two things sort of heighten the temporal quality. You don't have so much control over the material. I mean, in a book, you kind of control the duration of your comprehension. Here, you're not. There's a lot of room to read against the grain, but you're aware that you're reading against the grain. Whereas in a book, you kind of forget that you're reading in a book and in a linear way. Although I think reading, even in a book, is extremely varied as a practice. You know, there's skimming, There's various kinds of speed reading, and you know, then there was that excellent book by, of course, it was written by a French psychoanalyst, and it was how to talk about books you haven't read. You can also lie and say, "Oh, I read these books," when you haven't read them. And I remember, again, when I was at Columbia, of course, I had an orals list. There were, I think, 300 books on it, and I probably read only half of them. But you don't really need to read these books to have read them. You can read them in all sorts of other ways, in terms of understanding their context in a larger sort of set of information and data. So, the video that I'm in, are there any questions? We're gonna do a Q&A a little bit in here. So are there any questions that anyone has about that video that we just saw? And then I'm gonna screen the next video. Anyone? Yeah.
Do you plan to do more of this kind of poetry or poetic cinematic production?
Well, I've been experimenting with a number of different things. I wanted this to be about 24 hours long, so I've done another 3 or 4 hours of this, so it just sort of goes on and on. And I think the idea really in some ways is to have reading material in your house or something, and it just plays constantly. And you don't need to read it all at one time. You could read it over 20 years. So if it were playing every day for 20 years, you would say, "Oh gosh, I read that thing eventually," you know, kind of, or you kind of read it. And I'm really interested in those kinds of reading as opposed to sort of more directed, analytical, you know, more top-down reading practices. This, I would say, is a kind of allocentric or other-directed kind of reading. And again, that's why I think sort of reading this piece in a web browser and seeing it in a sort of cinematic, in cinematic form is very, very different. So if you're looking at this on a web browser, you're looking down into what's called a sort of parapersonal space. And it's a space immediately in front of you. It's closely associated with your body, and you kind of own it. And you control your sort of how you move through that text. But here, you have to sort of give it up in a way. And it's, you know, you have to drift through it. You can't catch some of it. Some of it's reading in ways that you don't expect, so you're reading against the grain. So there's more possibility, I think, for sort of getting lost or getting immersed in this kind of text. And it's kind of a reading environment. And I was at this, there was a sort of gallery show. It was done by a guy named Doug Wheeler. And it was at David Zwirner Gallery in New York. So what he did was he erased the front corner where the floor met the wall, and he curved it, and then he put extremely bright lights on in the back. So as soon as you walked into the space, you didn't know where you were. You couldn't see the end of the room. It just seemed to be an endless space, and you just completely got lost in this environment. And this, in some ways, was an attempt to sort of create a generalized reading environment that was comprised with sort of lots of bits of language that there would be a general awareness of reading, but it wouldn't really be close reading. It would be sort of reading that was taking place in the space. And maybe you weren't even reading at all. Maybe PowerPoint was doing the reading for you. So there's a bit of sort of anthropomorphism at work as well. Are there any other questions? Yeah.
Do you see a connection between this sort of overstimulation of media consumption on a day-to-day basis and what you're calling a parapersonal space, and then trying to relate that into a larger context of communication like you have done here? You know, we're all sitting here and we're seeing what you've kind of parsed through. And can you just speak a little bit about the specific brain chemistry, or not, maybe not brain chemistry, but how that process maybe happens, or how you can take something out of that and turn it into something that has a different meaning?
Right. You know, I think one of the things that this is sort of about is exactly as you've pointed out, there's just a lot of information. This, the sort of textual universe now is extremely full. So the question then becomes, well, how are you going to deal with all this text? In some ways, it has to be It has to be managed, it has to be tagged, it has to be customized, and these are all attempts in some ways. I mean, I see this as a very sort of autobiographical piece because it describes my interaction with information over a 3 or 4 day period. But there's so much, I mean, if we now are sort of so closely affiliated with our data and our status updates, managing our data becomes a kind of species of autobiography. You know, it used to be when you read a book, you like left a lot of yourself in the book, right? You wrote notes, you put post-it notes in, you scribbled and stuff. And now as we're sort of browsing through the web, we are the thing that sort of got left behind. So you have all these sort of services that actually track your progress through and provide some sort of, I mean, you know, sort of data management as a species of autobiography is sort of inherent in all these sorts of things. Whether this is a good thing or not, I don't really know. Maybe it's really a bad thing. I mean, I think the question here is, well, does this sort of openness to lots of different kinds of information open up something productive? Or are we just dealing with a fully administered space in life world where all the information is sort of sent to us? What sort of room is there for reading against the grain in some sort of way? And I would say maybe, you know, the mode of processing this is sort of, if you think of it as a kind of environment, neural Zen scientists have thought about this sort of processing as occurring in the ventral parts of the brain and involving sort of allocentric modes of attention. So maybe this is a sort of different attentional model that opens up a little bit of space where so much material is directed at you in very, very specific ways that are designed to sort of monetize what's known as the attention. So maybe there's a little, I don't think there's a lot, but maybe there's a little bit of freedom to read against the grain in this kind of environment. But it's certainly, yeah, it's certainly about an administered life world. Yeah.
Yeah, that was my experience in watching this, that each time that a word brought forth an emotion, that emotion was quickly taken away, or I shouldn't say the word brought forth the emotion, but I myself created an emotion in my associations with the word, and then boom, it was taken away, boom, it was taken away, and then I had the feeling that of these, of this infinity of words and signs and human beings as kind of, as if I were looking at human beings from a distance. And saying, look at this infinity of things that we've labored to create, and they're so arbitrary, and at moments they're poignant when they're connected, and it made me think about all the other languages, and it made me think about space in relation to words, and so on. So in that sense, it was liberating, mm-hmm. because I was forced out of my... I wasn't allowed to have associations, in a sense.
Right.
They couldn't stay with me. So anything you want to say about that?
Yeah, I think it's absolutely right to sort of talk about the sort of transient nature of most of our emotional life and the way we sort of experience most of our life. I mean, I think what psychologists have identified sort of 6 primary emotions like fear and anger and disgust. And I wasn't really after that at all. I was really interested in creating a much more generalized and even generic emotional or affective environment, and I would maybe call this something more related to moods as opposed to emotions. So yes, there was a definite attempt to sort of cultivate that, you know, what Heidegger maybe called Stimmung in describing that sort of sense of being in the world, the sort of, or what Antonio Damasio calls the background feelings. This is very much about sort of sketching out that particular attentional or allocentric framework for the processing of feelings and the doing of actions. So I think you're absolutely right to sort of talk about that as a way to frame our emotional life. And that's just because I think, oh, that's how we spend most of our lives. We spend our lives in a kind of mood state as opposed to something characterized by strong emotions. And of course, the minute you start to do something like that, then you're not really interested in creating what I would call as a sort of typical poetic or cinematic event, right? Like independent cinema is extremely good at creating emotions. I mean, we all go to the movies because we feel extremely strong, powerful emotions. And you often get incendiary content to do that. I didn't really want that. I wanted to stay away from those sharp, big emotions as much as possible and to stay with something much more low key. Thus, you know, affective states connected to sort of boredom, or, you know, as Sion Nagai has talked about, various sorts of, you know, things even having to do with cuteness. I tried to stick in some cute stuff in there too. like the, I don't think it showed up. It was the stuff about fabric softeners. Like I took my three favorite fabric softeners was bounce, bounce, snuggle, stuff like that. But I don't think it actually showed up there. It was blue, blue, and then I made it sort of black. Could you read it? I couldn't really see. Yeah. Yeah, was there another question? Yeah.
So why is it important that this project take place in language or use words? Or I guess another way of asking that would be like, what is the status of language in your work as compared with potential other media like images or music that could also be arguably sort of taken in a state of distraction and could call attention to our processes of attending to the world?
Yeah, I think one of the contours of reading is always non-reading. So as you point out, I think one of the things that I was sort of after here was creating a place where people didn't really feel like they needed to read this word for word, and so thus to denigrate the sort of language used to create sort of poetry. There's a lot of sort of amodal translation here, I think, in some sort of way. You know, their language, you know, language is sort of, you know, language is often used in poetry to create sort of ideas of rhythm. So I was interested, well, how would you generate rhythm in a PowerPoint piece? Well, part of it has to do with slide transitions, obviously. So there's a lot of that sort of, you know, sort of, I would call synesthetic or amodal translation going on. And yeah, there was an attempt to sort of, you know, a lot of these things referenced like text boxes and photographs and things like that, and just sort of align text in sort of graphical ways that made you think about, again, reading not as reading one word after another, but navigating an architectural space or a physical space. I mean, to the extent that there's still a lot of language there, it doesn't achieve that aim perfectly. But clearly I was sort of interested in, oh, well, let's regard language as a kind of a textual environment that needs to be navigated in a maybe a diagrammatic way. So there's a lot of captioning here, there's a lot of diagramming, there's a lot of paratextual material. I took a lot of this stuff from indexes and lists of plates in the back of books. This starts off with, I think, a Michael Asher listing of plates, things like that. So there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of gray literature and paratextual matter here. You know, stuff that was not meant to last, which references your earlier question, right? There's a lot of gray literary material that really, you know, it's either printed on fugitive. Nobody expects to save their SMS and IM messages for 10 years, but there's a lot of that in there, and now it's been preserved. But it is evanescent material. Yeah. Any other questions?
First of all, thank you. What I think this is a little goes into what you just said, only the other way around. What I thought, when I realized that I don't have the control I usually have when reading, didn't find that really liberating. I find that upsetting, really upsetting sometimes, specifically when it went faster and slower. You commented on the control thing. What I would like to know is if you could comment on the actual writing / designing process. This is not a blank page like we have this usually. This is PowerPoint gives you so many options, fading in, fading out, coming from the left, from the right. And when we talk about control, that the presentation itself controls our reading patterns, you as a writer or designer in this kind of sense, did it also control you a little bit? I mean, this would be a great way to brainwash people in the future. Did it control you a little bit, your writing process, how you made decisions, because it's PowerPoint and not a very passive blank white sheet of paper?
Yes. I mean, the minute you sort of adopt PowerPoint as a platform, you're thinking about a number of things. I mean, it's a very specific kind of office productivity software. As I mentioned, I was most interested in sort of the multimedia component, which is sort of Marshall's effectively, I think, in creating a kind of early emulation of a sort of Web 2.0 or 3.0 reading practices. But PowerPoint is also supposed to be didactic and powerful. And I was really interested in this case in creating a very, very weak PowerPoint presentation in those terms. you know, but is this lyrical? Is it kind of poetry? Yeah, it kind of has a rhythmic flow to it as well. So a number of genres are in play here. Twitter and a number of microblogging platforms I mined extensively here too. So you've got 140 characters. You've got the PowerPoint bullet points that are mounting from the bottom as opposed from the top, and some things are going from right to left. So there's a lot of spatialization of the reading practices and also temporalization of the reading practices that you don't really typically pay so much attention to in a novel or a codex, but in PowerPoint you do. So that time-based element and the platform-specific basis, the multimedia component, yes, of course, that's what the piece is all about in some sort of way. So you wouldn't really, I mean, I don't really, you know, when you read a book, you're like, you're supposed to lose yourself in the book and you forget you're reading a book. But here I'm never really, I never forget that this is a PowerPoint presentation. It's kind of a lecture. I mean, it doesn't really work as a PowerPoint lecture, but it plays with some of the conventions that are built into the platform. Yeah. Last question, and then I'll screen the last video. And we can take questions after the last video, too, because it raises a different set of issues in terms of, I think, different kinds of reading that take place. I mean, I tried to build as much variability of reading into that piece as possible. You know, so many different ways to sort of process information in terms of, well, in terms of aggregating it, in terms of collecting it, in terms of managing it, in terms of how you're reading it, and how it relates to how the text is actually being deployed. Yeah.
I mean, your work very obviously recalls futurist work, but not just in the obvious way, but I was actually thinking also that in the way in which a lot of futurists' engagement with typographical and printing innovations actually took place through them drawing the words on a piece of paper or so, and so it ended up actually being a very low-tech way of getting to what the future of technology would be like. And so there's something about your bibliographic soundtrack that was also sort of engaged with, you know, like you say, Twitter and Tumblr and Facebook and et cetera. But at the same time, it has sort of an early 90s aesthetic to it, where it's kind of, it's a low-tech PowerPoint. I mean, sort of low-tech digital images. So I guess my question is, I was wondering if for visual artists or for poets, if in order to engage a sort of what is the cutting edge of technology, or what is our, you know, what is a sort of futurist way of engaging with the world, does that always have to take place in using sort of low-tech or sort of earlier media or earlier sort of, or using an earlier aesthetic as a way perhaps maybe to sort of translate that as a form that poetry or painting or these traditional media could engage with? So is it actually sort of a translation of current technology into sort of a past mode, and so therefore the audience would be more of those who are engaged with poetry in its traditional sense, as opposed to trying to make poetry relevant towards people who are more engaged with the technology? And I also wondered if maybe, or else maybe perhaps whenever you engage with what might be innovative technology for the arts, you always have to sort of use an outdated style in order to keep away from the spectacle of it actually just being another Twitter, the same sort of entertainment value that Twitter or Facebook might have. So perhaps that might also be a, so I just sort of wondered what your process was in developing that style.
You know, the PowerPoint was used, this could have been done in JavaScript or something else too as well. And the particular look that I was interested in here really was, I mean, what's great about PowerPoint, and it's, well, I use it in the classroom too, so even people who don't really know PowerPoint very well can actually learn to use it in about half an hour. So much is now built into the PowerPoint platform in terms of the animations and stuff. It's just an easy platform to use. So that's really why I chose it primarily. The obsolescence thing, I mean, is still pretty active as a piece of office productivity software. So yes, but in terms of the technical effects, yes, they look of course DIY and antiquated and kind of rinky-dink. So. But I kind of find that, yeah, appealing. Maybe, yes, maybe things could have been flashier and stuff, but I really wanted something kind of slow and boring, and so it seemed to sort of fit that general aesthetic category. But, okay, I'm going to show the next one. It's called the Ph.D. Sound. Now, this was a project that I did for Artist Space. They had asked me to write an essay, a catalog essay, for a group of artists named Duox, and they had first shown at the Bard Curatorial Center, and then they were having a sort of solo show at Artist Space, and I didn't know anything about them. They were, I think, very young. They were 22 or 23. There was very, very little secondary material on them. And so Richard Burkett, who is one of the curators at Artist Space, and Amy Leung sent me a lot of material that they thought would be relevant about them. So this, in some ways, is an attempt to create a sort of, these are the materials I would have consulted or read to write an essay that I didn't write. So. And it's a very specific kind of reading that takes place when you're doing sort of scholarly work. You're going through a lot of material, you're trying to find material that's relevant, and you're basically skimming it. So this is a musical soundtrack. It's one of the few kinds of reading I can do with the music playing in the background. So, and this runs 14 minutes. We're going to run the whole thing. And it's got a soundtrack by Moscow Uno. And I was like, you know, like, usually you think about music. I mean, music is used to sort of customize our environment and our moods now, but I really wanted reading to sort of function as a background to other things that we were doing, partially because I think that's how reading is sort of being used today, but also because I just thought, oh, it'll be fun. Okay. This should be one. Thank you.
they want to him. Tell them. Tell them that they get what they want to him. Tell them. Tell them that they get what they want to him. Tell them. Tell them that they get what they want to him. Till then.
Thank you.
Maybe if you have any other questions, I could take some now. that was, you know, it was really an attempt to sort of play around with sort of graphic elements. You know, we did the sort of square boxes that are sort of reminiscent vaguely of a 12-inch LP, and to sort of integrate reading with sort of music and rhythm and those sorts of things. What was interesting about this was a lot of the sort of reading in terms of how the text is scrolling. I would just choose a sort of animation, so we'd erase one letter at a time, going left to right at a certain speed. And of course, this works to slow down speeding incredibly in some of the, I think the Plant Girl thing, where words are being put on one letter at a time and they're so small, because I just basically copied all this stuff. I was just appropriating text. So you get a lot of sort of automated reading practices that that I didn't necessarily control. A lot of this stuff was just, it's kind of authored by the PowerPoint platform in terms of how the material got read. So. And I was interested in New Order, of course. I mean, there's some lucky dragons in here for their idea of the sort of post-song environment, and this is kind of a post-book environment, maybe. But the New Order material, there's such tight integration with the graphic design of those New Order albums, and a new font, and you know, the music as well. So I was interested in working across these registers. So there's some sort of you know, amodal translation between typography, album design, and reading. Here, mostly paratextual bibliographic matter, and how it's, you know, you don't really read it closely, you kind of skim it. Yeah, any questions? Yeah.
I was just really interested in both texts, the issue of the reader conjuring and culling up things, so culling from what you shared, and also conjuring up, as the lady said before, their own associations, and how that desire to conjure, cull, read, relate doesn't die in either of these moments. At the same time, the like slow and fast flooding of information doesn't stop doing its own work, and it's nice that those two things don't cancel each other out, the desire to connect and cull, and from your own cullings and appropriations, and also the text refusing for you to get too close too long without missing all of it, like the ongoing flooding of it, you know. I like that those two things were able to happen, at least two things.
Oh, thank you. I mean, it's in some ways this was about just trying to make reading sexier than it normally is, I suppose. Yeah, other questions?
How you kind of imagine the difference or the sort of threshold between what you're setting up here, which is sort of compositional in a way, and the actual experience of kind of flooding these things, because that was what was interesting for me, is that even though there is this sense of distraction or that this sense of blurring that you want to create, there's also a kind of heightened sense of attention. You know, even to these sort of bibliographic artifacts and things like that, one is sort of watching oneself read, or watching oneself engage with this in a way that you don't if you're just. Do you know what I mean? I mean,
yeah.
that how like, because it seems like you're sort of creating a kind of a second object or a second shadow of reading. I'm not, you know, I'm still figuring it out, so I'm not putting it very well, but.
Yes, I think, reading is maybe one way to think about reading is it's just a highly syncopated or rhythmic processing of information. And another way to think about it, sort of as you're alluding to, simply has to do with the sort of shadow reading effect. So even though the text in some ways is being read by PowerPoint is, you know, it's an operation here, it's processing information, although this is a movie. So you get PowerPoint reading through material or processing other material. In this case, it's mainly bibliographic material. So, and you're reading with it, but you're also reading against it. So any reading generated in that sense is, I think, well described as a kind of shadow reading. But it raises issue about differences of reading, I think, that are intrinsic to, you know, you can read slowly, you can read quickly in PowerPoint because it's sort of, you know, and these are mainly arbitrary. I didn't really choose these. I was just sort of throwing these out there. So that very, very slow section, which is sort of my favorite one now, but is the most painful because it just takes so long to work through that plank girl pain. You know, you're just, oh, when will this end? So it's like, oh, that's kind of interesting because there you're being forced to read in a different way and the shadowing becomes apparent. But I think even with a book, you know, reading practices are actually so varied. You know, I do, especially with scholarly reading or bibliographic reading, you're skimming, but you're reading some sections very carefully. You're rereading a lot of the sections. And I think you have that sort of freedom to do the perform those kinds of, I don't know, residual reading practices in a PowerPoint piece as well. But it changes with the music and with the sort of animation of the text. Because, you know, in a codex, the text is not usually moving unless you've done something very strange to yourself or the book. Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah.
I wonder if you could say anything about your relationship to or the differences between you and some of the so-called conceptual poets. And I know you've been called an ambient poet, and this will sound fairly highfalutin, but I mean, I wonder about existential questions that come up in doing this kind of thing that may or may not come up with conceptual poetry, if you could comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that conceptual poetry is such a broad category now in terms of the kinds of stuff that are being
like Kenny Goldsmith and Vanessa Place.
Mm-hmm. There's a, I
Rob
mean, there's
Fitterin.
Yeah, there's a lot of appropriated material. So, you know, the use of appropriated material now is sort of expanded beyond a sort of tight conceptual frame in terms of the production of particular kinds of experimental writing or poetry. You know, I think the broad sort of parameters for what constitutes conceptual writing now, I think it's kind of an exciting moment for poetry because so much material is being generated now. There's this thing down in Zurich, I guess, run by Hans-Ulrich Obrist, which is called Luma 89. And they sent me a notice. They said, well, we're looking for anyone born in 1989 or after. And so, you know, that means you have to be 25 or under. And we're going to publish 1,000 books in 90 days. Please send us, you know, anyone you know who was born, you know, who fits that definition. So, you know, I think they published 400 books now. But the whole sort of timetable for publication now is very, very different. Because I published my first book. I was, it's called Lotion Bullwhip Giraffe. I was teaching at the University of Virginia then. I think I'd been there for 2 years. I was like in my mid-30s, and that was my first book. But now the publishing framework is so accelerated. I think most people by the time they hit 28 or 29 have already published 3 books. So you just have a massive change in terms of textual production. It's just so much dissemination of text, and then how you're going to manage that text and how you're going to customize it, how you're going to sort of make it your own. You know, I think of sort of, you know, I think maybe this is a little bit like Instagram. You know, you have a huge number of photographs that are sort of would sort of be dumped into what I would call a very, very short-term archive, i.e. they'd be dumped and they'd never be looked at again. You're just creating so much imagery. So what do you have to do? You have to somehow personalize or customize it or curate it. So there's so much self-curation of data now that's connected with who we see ourselves as. And that self-curation as a sort of practice is really filtered into a lot of, as you allude to, conceptual practice. But I think that now what's happening is, you know, the sort of straight ahead conceptual work has been sort of eclipsed. It looks like a very small dot in terms of how people are dealing with text in a larger environment. I mean, I think the conceptual frame that sort of Kenny Goldsmith does, that's very, very tightly organized, but it's still sort of based on, for me, you know, fairly autonomous aesthetic objects. But now it's very hard. The most interesting poetry books that I read today, I don't know what the fuck they are. I just actually don't know what they are. I'm quite puzzled by a lot of this stuff. So this guy, Kieran Daly, wrote a book called Null Appropriation. It's just, you know, exists on your desktop. It's a bunch of file folders, so it reminds you of a table of contents thing. And, you know, there's some JPEGs in there, and there's some other stuff. And there's an owner's manual, I think. I don't know what it is. Is it poetry? Is it some sort of, I mean, you know, like user manuals, that mode of literature. I mean, 15 years ago, we would never have sort of confused an owner's manual with a work of literature. But I think today, it's easy to make that that mistake, but it's not really a mistake. Yeah, any other thoughts, comments? Okay, thank you very, very much.